Anyway, well, welcome. And Patsy Krebs with us today, who is from the, well, was a friend of and companion with a lot of people from the Park Place Gallery Group. You'll see gallery, you'll see group. Are all of you, are you guys familiar with Park Place?
Okay.
Well, we'll kind of give a little bit of background about it, but it was a very interesting place in New York. In fact, there's a great show up right now. I don't know if you've been to it yet either. At the Great Gallery, which is the NYU gallery right there on Washington Square. I don't know if you're familiar with it or not, but they do really good shows. And they have one up right now. I can't remember the exact title, but the gist of it is Shaping Downtown or Creating Downtown or something like that. Artists collectors from 1952 to 65. And it's because downtown in New York was sort of wild and woolly back then, and places were very cheap and very easy for people to you know, access, and not usually the best conditions. A lot of them were warehouses and things. But it was a far cry different from the uptown scene on the Upper East Side, which is where most galleries were, and which included places like Martha Jackson and Leo Castelli and, you know, a number of those sort of galleries. But the downtown scene really pretty much, there galleries came in afterwards, but it pretty much was on 9th and 10th Street, a little bit later, but before that, further downtown, like where the Twin Towers were, the artists were creating collectives and showing a new kind of work, and that wasn't really being shown in the galleries uptown, and or was very experimental, sort of multifaceted with music, poetry. It was the Beat Generation. San Francisco had sort of the same scene. And so these collectives really kind of emerged and really defined downtown. And they include a lot of people who we all know today. I mean, who are these iconic figures, Rauschenberg and Klaus Oldenburg and Louise Nevelson, and, you know, on and on and on, and the Park Place Gallery Group. And so Park Place was on Park Place, which is right where the Twin Towers are, and it started in 62.
Well, Park Place was sort of like an abandoned, it wasn't abandoned, but it was a very funky loft building, about four stories.
Yeah, there's a storefront downstairs.
Yeah, and it was nothing, I don't think it was, even, yeah. But that neighborhood was the butter and egg and bacon and sausage neighborhood. Yeah, and which is now Tribeca.
Yeah.
Kind of. And so all the businesses were businesses that, like warehouses for eggs and butter, and then they would get distributed. So,
right.
So the activity in this place was huge trucks backing up into these buildings and, you know, loading all this stuff. And we had that building on Park Place, which was very primitive. And so, you know, there were, I think there were three floors occupied by artists, and then there was a top floor that was empty. And at some point, people in the building started just putting work up there and having very informal, mm-hmm. I mean, I know it rained inside that space. it was very, very primitive. And so, that was really the beginning of the Park Place Gallery, and then after a couple of years of this, the gallery moved up to
West Broadway,
mm-hmm. Right, just a little bit south, right in, you know, the University neighborhood, just a little bit south of Washington Square Park. I wanted to just say something about being in New York in the 60s. I was 20, 22, and I came from California. I went from California out there. But it was a unique time for us, really, because abstract expressionism had been the mode, and de Kooning and Rothko and all of that group were really, you know, the mainstream of abstract painting. And what happened right then in the 60s was that sort of cracked open into basically sort of three threads. And one was minimal, kind of minimalism, geometric, abstract painting. And one was pop art and the ilk, you know. And the third was participatory or performance art. So there were all different kinds of combinations with Steve Reich and all kinds of performance artists started to create a new medium in a sense.
So Capra was part of that scene as
Capra,
well.
Yeah, Capra, yeah. To be young and to be there at that time was really great. For one thing, it was such a small community that somebody like me, and there were many, you know, people like me, just young, I hadn't even gone to school yet, really, to study art. You could just kind of walk up and knock on somebody's door. Like, I was in Agnes Martin's studio, you know, she was just stapling up some work on the floor, and you could just go in and say, I just want to see what you were doing. What are you doing now? What are you working on now? And you were welcome. And you didn't even make conversation, you know, you just kind of looked around and said, thanks, and left. But you could, I mean, this was such an open, small...
It wasn't the mega star sort of thing.
It was, no, there weren't stars yet. And so it was a very accessible learning context, you know. It was very easy to be anonymous and observe and take in a lot.
Well, and a lot of young artists like today, they, you know, they always try and ask us dealers, you know, why is it so different? I mean, why can't we get a break? Why can't we, you know, get our work shown and get shows in the museums and all that? I'm like, well, we got to remember back in the 60s, they were it. These 40 or 50 people, that was it.
Yeah.
This year, now, I mean, there's 1,000 galleries literally in New York. Literally 1,000. Well, less 250 now after the last year, but that'll boom back up again. And there's probably, I'd have to say, 100,000 artists in Manhattan.
Oh, sure.
Easily. 200,000. And, you know, and back in the day, we're talking about, it was like 50, 100. I mean, everybody knew everybody. And so it just was a totally different world than it is now. And so, you know, and now, like what you're describing, I mean, you couldn't just walk up and get into Jeff Koons' studio, even if you wanted to. But you know, you couldn't get into Jeff Koons' studio, you couldn't get into any of these people's studio, because it's a whole different world. There's like this whole stratification now in the art world that there just didn't used to be. And the other thing, too, is galleries just weren't that many. And so, you know, when galleries had a show, it was a big deal. And when they were introducing new talent or putting together these shows, I mean, what was it? There was Martha Jackson and you know, the 57th Street Group and, you
Marlboro,
know.
Marlboro, I guess.
Yeah, Marlboro back then, Green.
Yeah.
So, you know, there were some good galleries. But the other thing, too, with Park Place, though, I think that's kind of interesting is they were a little bit different. I mean, all the collectives all have some sort of a theme about them, right? Because they're people who coalesce together about a common, you know, threat amongst themselves, some aesthetic or ideology or something. And the Park Place group wasn't that different in that regard. But it was structured. It was fairly structured, and there were five painters and five sculptors. And I think that came from the Sixth Gallery, which was three writers and three artists.
Oh, I don't know.
You know, I mean, Deborah Remington was part of the Sixth Gallery, and she gave Leo Valador, his break in his first show. And but again, that gallery was kind of a really hipster sort of gallery, and it was a beatnik generation, mid-50s in San Francisco. And that's also where Ginsberg had the first public reading of Howl. So there was always this combination of, you know, poetry, jazz, and, you know, art in San Francisco and in New York. They sort of flipped out jazz for performance a little bit, it seems like. But each place sort of had their own flavor of things going on. But the thing that I think really defined, you know, Park Place was everyone had this shared interest in sort of space and exploring space in like a third or fourth dimension. And so I think that's sort of what coalesced everybody in a way. There were five sculptors, included de Souffre, and then five painters. And so, but you know, when you look at everybody's work from back then, you realize it wasn't op art. but it was clearly visual perception, mm-hmm. and clearly creating these illusions in a two-dimensional picture plane. So trying to understand, you know, the human apparatus for, you know, eye-brain coordination and perceiving things. And so it was kind of interesting, but people also explored a lot with materials. I mean, so some of those DeSubro sculptures and things were quite wacky. I mean, and they sort of really created this, I don't know if he created it, he really played with sort of these asymmetric, you know, structures, and I mean, they were quite extraordinary and big. For, I don't know how he schlepped all that stuff up there, but...
machine.
Yeah, they were big sculptures and
heavy.
Well,
Park Place was on the ground floor. I mean, the new Park Place.
Yeah,
was on the
yeah.
ground floor, so it made it easy to get those big things.
Yeah, as opposed to the okay. top floor of the other building. Yeah. But I think that was kind of an interesting thing. So, like, your work, so if you didn't notice, Patsy's earlier, the drawings were right around the corner here. You were sort of into tondos and sort of these sort yeah. of creating this illusion of a volume in a ball or structure, but yet it was flat.
Right.
And very simple, very reductive.
Yeah, yeah. I think I started out with a grid and then gradually took the individual elements of the grid of circles and just isolated one, you know, and mm-hmm. developed it. But I was interested in the combination of somewhat of an illusion, but those circular, would you get that book, my book, that I could show? Yeah. like the black drawing out there.
Mm-hmm.
So those are actual ellipses, plotted ellipses.
Mm-hmm.
And I did them on a large scale, like 8 feet wide and 4 feet high. And I think many people in that group were interested in this kind of a magical moment when you see, you experience the illusion of space, but something immediately snaps you back to the flat plane.
Mm-hmm.
There's a kind of a free fall in between those two experiences. And that is a fascinating visual phenomenon. This is the only reproduction I have of...
Oh yeah, that I should have printed that out.
Of that painting and then the installation,
mm-hmm.
these two paintings.
Yeah.
But this was in the New Park Place gallery.
On Broadway.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can tell that a little more fancy lighting.
Right.
So this is the circular painting she's
yeah.
referring to. And you can look at this. This, by the way, is a brand new book. Just came out this week.
Yeah, just
so these are available through our gallery if you're interested. But it's... Patsy was clearly one of the painters, and so
I wasn't actually a member of Park Place, but I was, you know, a young person sort of around, you know, in the community, and there were a lot of invitational shows.
Oh yeah,
Linda Fleming was in one of the invitational shows, and Bob Swain.
And Saul LeWitt. There.
Yeah, Saul.
Donald Judd.
Uh huh. And Robert Gordon, the other
mm-hmm.
painter there.
So I mean, a lot of people passed through that place.
Yeah.
And it was kind of an amazing place that very community sort of focused, socially conscious, very socially conscious.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Probably one of the few or early ones where there was a sort of a conceptual underpinning to sort of the
mm-hmm.
the coalescence of these people. And but things were changing, you know, in the U.S. at that time in the mid '60s, and so it wasn't surprising.
Yeah.
And I point that out only because many of the earlier collectives from the '50s and '60s were more coalesced around formal concerns in art.
Mm-hmm.
There wasn't really a social cultural angle to it as much. Not like in Europe and Latin America, you know, where they coalesced around lots of different themes. But in the U.S., there were very few collectives and. At that time, most of them were in New York.
They liked writing manifestos.
Yes. Well, Ed Machowski was another one.
They liked writing manifestos. I thought that was funny.
Well, there are a lot of them who did that. The op art world was distinctly different. You guys didn't really interact a lot with the op artists.
And Escovitz.
Escovitz. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like that, yeah.
Stantec. It was really interesting because, see, those guys came up through... Joseph Albers. They all were students of Albers and studied at Yale. And that was a very big difference between when Albers was down at Black Mountain and the artists who came out of that, which included the sound guy, Rauschenberg was down there, as was Jasper Johns, mm-hmm. and who am I trying to think of, the guy who does the music, the
Steve Rush Holloway?
No.
Steve Rush?
No.
Well, Steve was there, but...
The composer.
Yes. It'll come to me. Wally Savonin was from there as well. But so those people came from a very different sort of ilk than the sort of more radicalized 60s.
And you know, the pop art group came from a slightly different realm also. They came in a way from commercial art. A lot of them were commercial artists, and they weren't as poor and destitute as the rest of us. And they might have been a little older too, I'm not sure, but there were these camps, but you know, those things are always more evident in hindsight, and when you start putting together art history, in actual life, there aren't that such clear...
But there was just so much going on in New York, and there were these different factions and camps.
Yeah, I mean, it was mostly groups of friends, mm-hmm. you know, hanging out. There was a lot of hanging out and talking about art and looking at art and drifting from studio to studio. And so it felt more like that, more like little cliques, social, mm-hmm. you know, people who, like, the Park Place people primarily came from San Francisco. We all came from San Francisco. And so in a way that park, the original Park Place building was inhabited by people from San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Or Tamara came from Boston to San Francisco to the Art Institute. It was the San Francisco Art Institute.
Yeah, that's a key point. I forgot to mention it earlier.
So I think just the fact that everybody was from, you know, a lot of people were from San Francisco created a kind of bond, you know, that was, you know, familiar species.
Yeah, that was sort of interesting too, because the whole San Francisco scene was so different. Because abstract expressionism, even though Clifford Still and a lot of people were out there in San Francisco and taught at the Institute, have lots of affiliations with the Institute, the West Coast AbX was totally different than the East Coast AbX. And largely driven by the fact that East Coast AbX was all rooted in basically European modernism and populated by mostly Europeans and immigrants from Europe. Whereas the Bay Area abstraction was really more people from big sky states who moved out that way and kind of wanted to be away from New York. And so if you ever look at and study these guys kind of carefully, you realize they're very different when you look at their work.
You know who was a big influence on Leo?
Who?
A person who was a big influence was Mark Tobey. Mm. Leo did a whole series of paintings that were directly influenced by Mark Tobey, and they were beautiful. And
what period
the Pacific Northwest, when he did them early when he still lived in San Francisco.
Okay, the late 50s. Yeah.
And so there was this Pacific Northwest group, Mark Tobey and Morse Graves, and if you look at Mark Tobey's paintings. At first glance, they seem like abstract expressionist paintings, but they are actually calligraphic.
Yeah.
And they're on a much smaller scale, and they aren't, you know, huge gestures. They are small gestures.
Right.
And it's a very, it's connected to the Pacific Asian world.
Right.
And that's an influence that, you know, I think a lot of West Coast artists have, and sort of subliminally.
Yeah, because it wasn't this concern with, you know, the abstract expressionism in the West Coast wasn't as concerned, it seemed like, with this being this emotive outpouring, you know,
and
part of the soul.
Declarative of the person. I am here, this is me making these remarks.
And they were more kind of, I don't know, if you look at a lot of them, there were structures, they were organized, there were elements. It wasn't just gestures and things. Yeah. There was like some thought to how they were composed, it seemed like. And very interesting, you know, work. And so we've represented a scat of these guys out on the West Coast, and I've always liked that work a lot. Not that I don't like the East Coast, it's just that there was a lot of it that's just been untapped and not mined. And there's some beautiful paintings that are really great paintings that are very accessible, you know, price-wise and physically accessible, whereas you can't, you know, get hardly any Motherwells anymore. They're definitely not Franz Klein or De Kooning and these guys, and definitely not Barnett Newman. So, I mean, that's the difference, you know, between those two worlds. But it sort of was interesting because, you know, this group came from the West Coast and imported themselves into New York.
Yeah.
And it behaviorally was different. It was a distinctly different group.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're all represented. Almost all the founding members are included in that show now at Great Gallery, and that's up through March. So if you're in New York, you really ought to go. I haven't been yet myself. Richard and I were going to go actually last weekend, but plans changed. And because I really want to see it, it's kind of the area I've always been fascinated with. And I've always loved Park Place and the Park Place Gallery and many of the artists. I mean, we started representing Bob from the get-go when we opened. And I didn't realize Bob had been a friend of the Park
Bob
Place.
Bob Swain.
And that's Bob Swain's painting right there, the big blue one. And but we'd started working with Leo in his estate a long time ago, and that's sort of what got me kind of more interested in it. And I don't know, I just have always really liked the work a great deal. There were also a lot of people who passed through that were really very interesting people, like Neil Williams. Died, unfortunately, very early in life at age 53, but he, you know, probably could have had the same career as Stella. I mean, they were sort of paired up a lot in shows, and but he was a big proponent of shaped canvas and really trying to explore, you know, painting, what is painting, you know, what is really the canvas and how you define that. But a lot of artists, you know, struggle or you know, with the edge of the canvas versus the center and the shape and all of that. That was a big thing in the 60s and 70s, and that's why we tend to focus on that a lot in our galleries, shaped canvases, because that exploring materials, exploring shapes, exploring color, and kind of moving out of the formal, purely formal concerns, by that I mean just shape, color, composition, to imbuing things with content, which is really kind of what happened in the late 70s, 80s, with the whole shift into out of minimalism and into conceptualism or conceptual art. So there was a lot of interplay between a lot of these people, and they sort of paved the way, a lot of them. This is Mario Rosari, who's an interesting guy. Mario, like Leo, was Filipino, but they didn't know each other until they hooked up in New York. And Mario, when he left art school, just decided to not use paintbrushes anymore and wanted to just explore any way of transporting media, paint to canvas other than a brush. And that happens to be airbrush. And if you sit where I'm sitting right now, you can see the airbrush, how he did each one of those. And I can see like every other one now, I never noticed it till now, is opposite orientation. That purple one in the middle is left to right, the pink one's top to bottom, the blue one is left to right. I just now noticed that. But it looks like it was brushed. And then the painting out here, the red one, when you guys leave, you can take a look. That was actually a stencil using rubber mats from a restaurant. You know, the big rubber pads that they work on. And he was working in a restaurant, and when he was cleaning them at night, he would, you know, they'd take them out in the alley and throw them down, and they'd make these splash marks, and he was picking them up going, well, those are kind of cool. And so that's how these paintings came about, was putting paint on the, you know, laying them on paint and then throwing them on the canvas and, you know, airbrush and all these things. I mean, it was so experimental, you know, and I think these paintings are stunning. I love them. And all of his paintings are really interesting. And he loves stencils and things like that. And so it was just a very interesting experimental sort of space, because his work and a lot of these people from Park Place, the world looked totally different than what was happening uptown, you know, in other parts of New York. So I think it was this acceptance and openness to people. The landfill that we have in the back is not from that period. Although there is a reminiscent element, which is that blue bar at the bottom. Ronnie did very large paintings, a lot of times diptychs that were sort of bordered.
Who?
Ronnie Landfill.
Oh, Is that his painting?
Yeah, one in the back.
I thought it was one of Dean's.
It looks a lot like Dean's, yeah. But it's an 80s painting. and it's stained on prime canvas, mm-hmm. and then that big acrylic bar at the bottom. Mm-hmm. But Ronnie started exploring really, really large paintings, very, very minimal reductive, that were just with borders and sort of boundaries in his earlier work from the 60s. And they went into this, and he's pretty much stuck with this ever since. But he was one of the last shows, I think, at mm-hmm. Park Place.
I went to California, so I wasn't there. But Park Place, you know, was relatively short-lived.
4 years.
Yeah, because what happened was Patrick Lannan was the supporter mm-hmm. of Park Place when it moved. And shortly after I left, he hired Paula Cooper to mm-hmm. be the director. And then it pretty soon became the Paula Cooper Gallery. That was the origin of the mm-hmm. Paula Cooper Gallery.
And that's where the conceptualism also, because you know,
then
she's
a lot
sort
of the artists
queen of
were
that.
No longer in the gallery.
Right.
Because it was really her gallery. So she chose, you know, she kept Robert Grosner and some of the artists, but a lot of them were not invited to become part of the Paula Cooper. And so that kind of liquidated Park Place.
What were the dates again that it was in existence?
I'm not sure when. I mean, I left New York in 66, so I missed, you know, I wasn't privy to a lot.
It was pretty much, it was 63 through 67, pretty much was the heyday of Park Place. Mm-hmm. But, you know, people started morphing and kind of going in different directions, yeah. and then more galleries kind of pop up uptown, and you know, and a lot of what was different and experimental became sort of the norm, you know, and so the art world sort of shifting, you know, a bit then, and
you know, it's not as categorical as it seems, because I'm looking at that painting back there, and a lot of, like, Helen Frankenthaler was staining canvas and doing some very powerful, simple form, large floating simple forms. You know, and Rothko, Ad Reinhardt was doing minimal paintings before anybody yeah. even thought about it. And those were those people were influential on the younger generation also. So I mean, it's things do kind of bleed over. And,
oh yeah, there's tons of overlap.
Yeah, there's a lot.
So we have a question from Facebook.
Oh, okay.
So Jamie asked, even though most great movements occur as a result of artists in groups, and now with the onset of the internet, globalization, does the idea of the group still exist? And how necessary is the element of human interaction on artists' success as a group as opposed to separation via internet grouping?
Well, I'll take a shot at that. I think artist interaction is still really important, and especially with young artists, because they crave the critique and criticism. I mean, everybody really wants to have some feedback mechanism, and the best way of doing that, I mean, you can get Instagram and your friends like it and what have you, but that's it. You get a click. You know, it's not the same unless somebody really sends you a comment or calls you or something. I mean, I think Instagram is still a great way for people to socialize an idea or concept or get sort of, you know, put it, buy-in. But here in Santa Fe is a good example, I think, of a microcosm of the world. Artist collectives are really on the rise here. A number of them. There are a lot of them. And a lot of them have even started combining writing and, the visual, and sort of writing about work and trying to put it into words or explain it and have some sort of a critique. I think, you know, these kind of talks and things like that are people really like, and I think they're really important. So I think artist interaction is still vitally important and critical for the development of sort of new ideas and new concepts, and because they feed off of each other. That's how it builds. And so I think it's still very vital. I mean, I think things get accelerated in terms of acceptance and then proliferating with the internet. But I think some of those nuggets of ideas really get nurtured and developed, I think, by people interacting and talking with one another and sharing their ideas and experiences. That's my thought. So I still think there's a place for critique and criticism, and that human interaction and coming to openings and seeing shows in galleries and where it's presented with enough context around it to get, you know, really get the feel for the work or the concept or idea. And that's why in this show we tried to show multiple pieces, even though like Patsy's a great example of hers around the corner here. Some of these are from the 90s, early 90s.
These two paintings right here are from the 90s.
And then brand new work. But you still see a thread in her work. Geometry for sure, but aside from that, there's a consistent thread of this illusionism or volume. Now I think your work has definitely gotten more complex, but it also, this work has like a portal feel to it. So it's kind of, there's more to them, I think, in terms of mystery about them, as opposed to just volume or space or illusionism. So these almost take on something kind of metaphorical, like a portal or a passageway or mm-hmm. some sort of a view into something, you know, interior. Mm-hmm. They remind me a lot, even though they're, you know, geometric, of Leon Berkowitz's paintings, where Leon explored color and didn't want people to look at color, but to look through color. Because mm-hmm. he felt like color was like a passageway into a soul mm-hmm. or into how you think. Because he was a very early proponent, like Bob Swain, of how color is a huge trigger of the human psyche and emotions. Mm-hmm. And so that's why Bob's paintings are so systematic to explore the combination of palette and shape or dosage, if you want, of pigment. Mm-hmm. You know, because it affects how you feel when you look at these paintings. That's also why Bob works in scale, large scale. But that also comes out of like Barnett Newman. He worked in scale because he wanted you to be immersed in the work. Same thing with Rothko. So abstraction has always kind of dealt with a lot of things happening at the same time, scale being one of them, mm-hmm. I think. Because if you look back in the 60s work, 50s work, and even before, it was big. It was really big. And you're thinking, mm-hmm. wow, these tiny apartments in Manhattan. Who was buying this stuff, you know? And it's like, you know.
Ellsworth Kelly was another really important person.
Yeah.
Because Kelly would see something like, I'm looking at that doorway, and it's a kind of rhomboid, because it's in perspective. And then he would lift that form exactly mm-hmm. like that and paint it as a flat form so that it has that same quality of being both apparently dimensional,
right.
perspectival, and also very flat. I mean, emphatically flat.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, that's just that can take so many visual forms.
Mm-hmm. Really. Well, take a look at when you guys leave the Leo Valador. It's a small painting, but it's a very powerful painting, the orange and yellow one. Mm-hmm. Down around the corner there, and Leo did that. He would take these shapes, and he didn't use, what's the word I'm looking for? Why am I completely escaping the word? You know, he didn't use like shading or shadowing to create this illusion of volume. Mm-hmm. He kept everything very flat, but he liked to use shaped canvases and very few colors, but distort the shape within a shape. And so in that orange painting, it's just cropped off at the top. But what makes it powerful then is and that triggers your mind to be looking at things in a different way. And then he took a yellow plank and just looked like he went like, and just sort of twisted it. But all he did was just sort of, you know, just sort of shifted the shape. And then that being within that plane that is lopped off, now you're thinking, oh my God, those are like two shapes, one coming out at me and one going away from me, you know, sort of thing. But to really elevate it a little bit, he used ellipses and circles. Did you mm-hmm. notice that? There's only five. There's three circles and two ellipses. Mm-hmm. And the ellipses are very important because he directs your eye to which one's going out and which one's coming, you know, in. And so it's really kind of interesting because those, because an ellipse always conveys some sort of distortion or perspective or something, and a circle doesn't. So it, the circles tell you where the plane is, and those ellipses, you know, then kind of direct your eye in or out on these other forms. It was really clever. And they were shocking colors like pink or gold or something, you know, which was totally out of character. The pink, so when you look at it, it looks sort of like this sort of modernist interpretation. It looks Kandinsky-ish or something, you know. But then when you start looking at it, you're realizing, when, and I've studied his work a lot, you realize he was playing with this illusion of things floating and shifting in space. And then he realized when the Park Place was sort of concerned with this whole notion of the fourth dimension, you know, the Twilight Zone and all of this, you realize, wow, I mean, you know, he did this his whole life. I mean, he kept pursuing this his whole life. And for a lot of these people, it's like Bob, this has been a lifelong endeavor. Bob's in his 70s. He's been doing this for over 50-some years, this systematic painting. And he's characterized over 5,000 colors. He doesn't use the standard sort of, you know, color systems that are out there. He's created his own for doing what he's doing. So, I mean, it's just this invention kind of keeps happening, it seems like, with a lot of these people. Dean keeps reinventing himself. It's like every decade is a whole different sort of genre. It's kind of interesting. If you notice that, the green book up there is a brand new one, actually, on Dean as well. So you can take a look at that one, and you can kind of flip through it chronologically and see, you know, how he sort of moved, and he's come back full circle. These paintings in the back are brand new, and he's back to the hard edge geometric.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting how he's kind of gone through this whole move. Do you guys have any questions for Patsy, or? You don't have to come up with one now. And when did you move? I can't remember, to New York. Yeah.
Me. I didn't. I was really in New York kind of in the early 60s and ended up back in L.A.
Oh, okay.
And Chouinard's Art Institute.
Oh, yeah.
One of those West Coast people. That, and when they were first connecting with New York. I was going to ask Patsy about the connection with San Francisco and L.A.
I went from the Bay Area to New York and then to Southern California.
Okay.
So that's what happened. When I left New York, I moved to Los Angeles. And it's interesting what you're saying about collectives and interaction. I think it's so individual what you need. Mm-hmm. You know, and some people, you know, need a lot of feedback and critique. And I felt when I was in New York, really, that I was so I had just so barely started painting when I was doing these round paintings. I just felt that there was way too much influence, and that I wanted to figure out what I would do, what I really wanted to do on my own, and if it would be anything like this. I needed to separate that out. So I went to Los Angeles, not because I was interested in the Los Angeles art scene, but just to get away from everything. And I got married. I married a musician, so I sort of got more involved in the music world there. And that was good for me because I could paint without having to think about where I fit in to this or that camp. I was just interested in seeing what I want, you know, what would develop. Then eventually I went to graduate school in California and started teaching there. Coincidentally, there was a movement in LA, and that's that space, light space. Yeah, light and space movement, which my work in a way did relate to. Mm-hmm. Although I wasn't actively involved in it in any way. I enjoyed some of the work, but. And it may just be, you know, something about the West Coast and the light there. Because I think probably we're always affected somewhat by our visual surroundings. You know. So that's how I got to Los Angeles and then eventually moved to Northern California.
I think on the notion of sort of like nurturing ideas and things, I think artists crave that, I think, when they're starting out or trying something new and experimental. But I think you're right. Many artists complain about that even in New York right now. Mm-hmm. When they go to New York, they have to be really disciplined because you can go to an opening every night. You can go to a studio visit every day.
Yeah.
You can, you know, there's so many things to do because there's so many people. And you have to figure out how to structure your time to be disciplined. Mm-hmm. And especially if you're there on a fellowship and you have 1 year.
Yeah.
You know, you've got to get something done. And so you've got to really balance that, engaging in discourse and kind of figuring it out on your own. You know, because at the end of the day, you've got to have your own voice. You've got to have your own perspective, mm-hmm. even if you're part of a collective.
Mm-hmm. You know, we're all influenced, obviously.
Yeah.
We can't help but be part of the time that we're in and sort of... we have this broader context that we're working within, but it's important to have a kind of vital link with what you are really interested in, because if you get too lost in fitting in or doing something that's going to be acceptable to this or that world, you can lose the primary companionship of the work.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and that's what you have. That's what you have for the rest of your life, really, is this companionship. Mm-hmm. And it can get lost. It can get lost if it's no longer fun. And it's like, oh, is this going to work? Is somebody going to like this?
But there are a lot of collectives where I know artists for 4 or 5 years realize, I've got to get back to my own practice. Not that they want to depart from the collective.
Some people work really well.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so individual.
Like, it's totally individual.
It's like your basic nature and your temperament and stuff.
But a lot of people, you know, even when they're in a collective and they're very successful, sometimes they still want to have... I mean, bands are like this.
Yeah.
You know, musicians are like this. They're in a band and in a group, but yet... A lot of times they'll do their own solo work. I mean, because there's something else they want to explore outside of that. And artists are the same way, visual artists. And so it's not surprising. You know, it's just kind of human nature.
Yeah.
And but I do think the collectives are definitely on the rise, at least here in Santa Fe. And I think in a lot of other cities, like in Oakland, Detroit, Chicago, there's more and more collective sort of activities because you don't have... the density of the scene in New York and LA. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, there's more and more groups coming together because as they come together, it creates a little bit more critical discourse around their medium and support.
Well, support. And, you know, some of the large scale support like the NEA and things like that have sort of melted, you know, in terms of just, that's financial support.
Mm-hmm.
The old NEA grants. That,
right.
You know, 70s or whatever.
Yeah.
But it is a kind of recognition that you exist and that your work has meaning. And some of those larger things are, you know, not there. So I think people get together just to provide kind of vitality to to
the work. And I think people do drift in and out of that, the need for that or the desire for it throughout their careers. Well, I think a lot of times when people have sort of a turning point, there's always this sort of, you know, desire to have some sort of a feedback mechanism or support of some sort.
Yeah,
because
it's definitely...
There's not a big safety net in the art world.
Really?
at any level, you know, it's we're, you know, seeing right now, I mean, it's, you know, things can just get flipped on their head overnight. And, you know, and so there's not a lot of support. And so... And there's always, you know, things changing and happening in terms of, you know, internet and auctions and all sorts of other things that affect, you know, the art world. So it's a very dynamic apparatus, you know, because there is a whole apparatus around it, all the way from the teaching and artist practice to, you know, museums to galleries to, you know, collectors and everything. So it's all part of the whole same thing. But that all kind of keeps shifting and morphing.
And artists really need for other people to see their work. And that is another reason why groups and collectives are great, you know, because the work originates in a kind of solitary studio experience.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes somewhere. part of the life of the work is to land somewhere and be experienced by somebody. So if you don't have gallery representation, or if you don't have, you know, some kind of, just having the work just stack up against the wall in your studio can be very difficult. And mm-hmm. so if you have a community of people who are watching what you're doing and seeing it, that's the completion of that arc. And mm-hmm. it's, you know, it doesn't give you any money to live on, but at least the work is experience, which is the sort of the soul life of the work. It needs to land.
Another question from Facebook. Do you think when starting a group, artist movement, that the key focal point, focal thought point, would be to have an ism to push a movement? For instance, intrusionism is an idea that artists may get behind as a point of expression for the movement. How important is an ism?
Well, I think isms kind of come out of our history. So, I mean, it's like you said before, you don't really know you're having an ism when you're doing it, you know? So I think the isms kind of come afterward. I mean, and the isms all came out of, you know, the guy from MoMA. Sorry, I'm having a bar. You know, cubism and expressionism. And you
Ism is a discursive thing. And usually work doesn't get made out of a discursive mentality. It gets made out of a focus on something, like a focus on something that takes on a life of its own, and it has to grow, and you follow it in mm-hmm. a way. And so isms usually are a way of gathering things together by what they have in common after they exist. Mm-hmm. I think. That's what I think.
Yeah, I mean, if you look back at some of the more recent movements,
Manifesto.
Yeah, I mean, there wasn't a manifesto sort of defining it as much as sort of a group of artists. I mean, I think, like, you know, when you look in the 70s in the hyper-realism movement out of mm-hmm. Los Angeles mm-hmm. is a good example. That kind of came out of UCLA, mm-hmm. A lot of artists. And
they got interested in that, and they influenced each other, and it happened. Yeah. I don't think they said, let's have a realism
right.
movement.
Yeah, they didn't, that's what I'm saying. They didn't really define it. It was probably some group of professors who were sort of doing that, and they started doing it. And a lot of isms back then were very regional. Now they become national very quickly. But, you know, there were lots of examples of where they're very regional, you know, like out of Texas or Chicago or L.A. or something. And so I think that's what, you know, it was kind of fun. Yeah. And there was a regional aspect to a lot of things. Just because we didn't have the internet and everybody seeing it within 2 seconds of, you know, clicking the picture. So that might change. But yeah, I agree with you. I think it comes out of people having a shared interest in something that's happening at the time.
Yeah.
And there's then becomes a collective or a concentration or body of work that people start realizing a pattern mm-hmm. or a similarity or, you know, something. And I think that's how they kind of come out of. I think if you sit around, it's like any idea, if you try to sit around like, I'm going to come up with the next $1 million invention, mm-hmm. you'll never do it.
Well, you know, another word for ism is genre. Yeah. I mean, that's a little bit, you know, less elevated maybe, I do think, you know, there are artists in the world who think of themselves as working within a genre, but I don't think that way, and, you know, I suppose, you know.
Yeah, I think people, a lot of times, like, we have people contact us and say they consider themselves a color abstractionist or whatever, you know, so people...
It's just sort of a handle.
Yeah.
You know, so that somebody, you can tell somebody what it is you do.
Yeah, but all of their work is totally different when you look at them, you know. Yeah.
Is it possible to create a movement leading with an ism, and why not?
I'm sure you could do it if you wanted to.
With the internet, you could anymore. And with Twitter and Facebook and Instagram, I think. So, yeah.
I'm trying to think. The Park Place Gallery did not really have an ism.
No, it was really around space. It was reconsidering space. And
Mark Rothko made the statement in one of the manifesto moments. We are for the simple expression of complex thought. And he used E equals MC squared as an example. I mean, as a, not an example, but as a, what would you call it? That I think is probably about as narrow as a ism should get.
Yeah, I don't know. I have to think about that. I can't think of any where people just sort of set out and said, "This is what we're doing," and have something
if
happen.
If it's not well, there are these subtle things that happen. I think within groups, though, they're sort of subliminal. But there are soft limitations that if you exceed them, you will find out by others, you know, that you're sort of mm-hmm. going outside of this cloud
yeah.
form. So there are. It's not completely wide open. You know, when people are exploring,
right.
and experimenting.
Did you ever get involved in another group that was anything like the Park Place group?
Yeah, no, I didn't. In fact, I wasn't really that involved in Park Place. I was in the community, and I lived in the Park Place building, the first one. And I found that I functioned better. Mm-hmm. But also, it did come up in when I moved to San Francisco. But by that time, I was in my 40s, and I was in what I was doing, but there was an abstract painting group there, sort of headed by David Simpson, his work.
Oh yeah.
Who was teaching at UC Berkeley, and there was a small group of minimal abstract, some field painting and some geometric painting, they were friends of mine. But I just didn't somehow become a real mm-hmm. once a month meeting person and get into it. Just not group oriented. I heard.
It must have been part of the time period too, in the way New York was back then.
I think so. It was very.
But there was a need. I mean, so yeah. They sort of emerged out of
this
need. There was a need.
Yeah, and it was so. Really valuable. And as I said, you know the. You had this group of people who were really interested in what you were doing. That was the great thing, was to have somebody come over and seriously look at what you're doing and respond and say, yeah, I get it. I think I get what you're doing.
Even just to have friends, I mean.
That, yeah. That's what it is.
You know, I moved out here from New York.
Really?
And, you know, a lot of people don't really, it's such a different life. You know, mm-hmm. you don't realize it sometimes when you're in New York. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't, they don't understand that, you know, you've lived your entire life paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And somehow you don't have a lot in common because of the way you've lived.
That's true. Sometimes.
You mean the people here?
Well, yeah, every man. Well, I moved, actually ended up moving to the suburbs in New York, and it was that kind of the same thing. Mm-hmm. Everybody worked for IBM in my neighborhood.
Yeah.
It's hard to make a transition to bourgeois life when you've been stealing electricity from the city and stuff like that. Dean and these Frosty, the old building, they had figured out some way to get electricity. I don't even know if anybody was paying rent, or if they were paying rent, it was something like $35 a month for the entire building or something. And nobody ever came around and
checked on it.
It was being rented, but you weren't supposed to be doing art there. And Forrest Myers, who is a sculptor, built a wall so that it looked like, maybe you couldn't live there. That's right, you could have a studio, but you couldn't live there. So he built a wall out of canvas and gessoed it, and it was tight, and it looked like a plaster wall, and on the other side he had his little apartment, and the fire department came. There was smoke or something, and went at that wall with an axe. It was just canvas. It was great. And everybody was always worried about the building department, and oh God, the building department's coming. It's like, you know, the enemy is coming. The SS. It was very funny. It was hilarious, you know.
Yeah.
Everybody was so young. Nobody cared. You know.
Yeah, well, they're going to throw you out.
Things did. Yeah, I mean, I could never live that way now.
Yeah.
We become more middle class as we get older.
Are there collectives going on now in New York, or is it really more about the galleries?
Well, in New York right now, I would say it's really galleries. I mean, artists are definitely wanting to get into galleries. That's their goal. And that's why they stayed here for so long. There are collectives that are emerging, like in Brooklyn and in places where artists are sort of coalescing together and getting space together and things like that to try and, you know, share expenses and what have you. So they are kind of popping up in that regard. And some are popping up to present work. So yeah, I would say that they are emerging. But it's just like here, the collectives came here out of a need here in Santa Fe. A lot of there were so many artists and the galleries just couldn't, you know, fit everybody in. And so what's ended up happening, and some of the artists, their work was just different. It just didn't fit into any specific gallery here in town. And so they kind of emerged as a need to be able to have presentation of a body of work to sort of convey a message or a new visual aesthetic. And so that's sort of, I think, what's happened here. But again, it's coming out of a need, mm-hmm. you know. So, and they have popped up in other cities out of the same thing, a need over time. So it's not like there hasn't ever been any collective since 1967 till now. There's always a need. It depends on the area. But I think we are seeing it in New York again more popping up because, first of all, people have been having for the last decade or so to move further and further out of the city because they just can't afford it to live in Manhattan. And so they're moving to Brooklyn, and now Williamsburg has become expensive, so now they're moving out to Bushwick and then to Utica. And, you know, it just keeps moving further and further east and out by the LaGuardia Airport, what have you. So, It's a need, and I think they're coalescing. And again, I think they're starting to kind of pop up and have their own spaces and different things. So if you go to New York and look at the publications or go online, you'll see lots of gallery openings. I mean, all over places you've never heard of. Mm-hmm. And so they're happening. It's it's more now because of a financial need. In New York, it's too expensive to live in the city, and it's so hard to get into the galleries in Manhattan that's why a lot of them are popping up in the boroughs and over New Jersey.
Well, in Los Angeles, there's the Santa Fe Art Colony, mm-hmm. which we have several artists from there. And so it's live workspace, and then they also have exhibitions in
in New York. I mean, LA's changing too because, a lot of the galleries in New York and Europe and other places are opening up spaces there, and there are some more people trying to coalesce around some of these communities where there live work spaces and they have open studios. That's always been kind of a common thing, even in New York. So there's been more of that happening. They're not so much coalesced around a theme, like the Elizabeth Foundation in New York and some of these others. They, it's not like there's a thematic relationship between them. Genre. They just happen to be all sharing space, and they decide, during Armory Week in New York to have open studios.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, because there's an extra 300,000 people in New York looking at art. So, they kind of pop up that way. And same thing around Basel, you get that, and around Miami in December and things like that. So you get lots and lots of these places popping up, which is fun and it's interesting and it's exciting for them. It's very exhilarating for the young artist, mm-hmm. and it's an opportunity.
Yeah.
It's
an opportunity to have somebody look at your work.
Yeah. So
see what you're doing.
There's always a need, but it's anymore it's very regional and localized, I think, depending on sort of what the economic situation is or the gallery situation or what sort of an art apparatus really exists to support artists. Mm-hmm. And so that changes, I mean, there's a bunch of them. You ought to Google some of them. Artsy is a publication that does a lot of these sort of analyses, which is very interesting. And there's a whole group. They periodically, and a lot of times, I don't know what time of year they do them, but they were kind of on a roll last year, like with Oakland and Seattle and other cities about collectives and, you know, small new startup galleries and things like that. And they're kind of fun to go because then they have lots of images there and they give you the websites and everything. And so there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of work going on there. And they don't last long. It's like Park Place, these things. Yeah. They come, they go, you know, people, yeah. they get into a gallery or they get married or they get a professorship someplace and, mm-hmm. you know, it just happens and they sort of, mm-hmm. you know, and then something else pops up. But that's, I think, part of the ephemeral aspect of them is part of their charm.
Yeah.
At the same time, it's a fleeting moment. So when it's happening, you need to be part of it. You need to go, you know. And so it's not like it's going to be around forever, right. None of these things. So I think that's kind of the dynamic. Yeah. The dynamics of it, I think, are what's exciting and keep them kind of fresh and energetic mm-hmm. for people. It's great for us gallerists, you know, I mean, but you just can't go to all of them. There's more and more of them than you could possibly go to. But that's how we meet a lot of people. So we go to some of the collectives and mm-hmm. meet folks.
Can you talk a little bit about the Santa Fe Art Project and collectives here in Santa Fe?
Yeah, the Santa Fe Art Project is something we started last year. And again, because there were some of these collectives popping up, and they were trying to do pop-up spaces, and you know, and we decided, well, what we would do is start doing programming in our gallery, we started to do our projects, which was not necessarily limited to local artists. It was basically any artist who we really weren't representing, but we wanted to give them a show or give them a break or include them in a two-person show or a guest curator. And so, but then we decided with so many of the collectives that were popping up in Santa Fe, we would do the Santa Fe Art Project. And that happened to be focused last year just in the fall. And we had over about 60 artists and 7 guest curators, because we have a lot of really talented curators here in town as well. So we were trying to give them a break to curate a show of local emerging and mid-career artists here in town. So the whole thing was to focus on the sort of breadth and depth of these really talented people that we have here in Santa Fe that didn't necessarily have gallery representation. And we decided to focus on the collectives, and again, to give them sort of, a shine on them and let them sort of show their, you know, curatorial talents and sort of who some of the artists were in their collectives. And this year, just because we've been having a hard time finding a space large enough to do all this at one time, this year we decided we're going to do it year-round. So we're dedicating a chunk of our gallery to solo shows for young emerging artists and big career artists here in town. And then we're also going to be doing probably 4 times this year have guest curators curate a chunk of the gallery, again, focusing on local talent. So we're trying to do that so that people realize Santa Fe's always been an art colony. I mean, not always, but is very well known for art colony, is an art colony. But there's a very vibrant contemporary scene here that I think a lot of people outside of Santa Fe don't realize. And that's what we're trying to do, is get people to realize this is a great place to come if you like contemporary art and you like and want to support, mm-hmm. be a patron, if you will, of emerging artists or mid-career artists. That's why we did it. It was just to try and get people to shine a light on Santa Fe and really show the range of work that's here. And there's a lot of contemporary art in Santa Fe. So that's something we decided to do as just one gallery, but we welcome other galleries to participate and do things. And, you know, but again, it's sort of like our collective of collectives, right? So there's sort of a need to shine a light on Santa Fe and the contemporary community here. So we've sort of created a collective of collectives and a collective of, you know, these emerging artists, so that, again, we get a concentration and a critical mass to get some critical attention mm-hmm. and to get collectors and people to reconsider Santa Fe, not only just as an art town with 16 or 17 really great museums that range from all sorts of genre and periods of time, because Santa Fe kind of reads like a history book. I mean, you know, there's so many people who move here and bring their art with them, and so we have everything here. It's amazing. There's not very many cities other than New York and Los Angeles and San Francisco where you can get the sort of diversity and the specificity of galleries that we have here. You know, it's just kind of unusual. But it's because we're a melting pot of so many people. And we had so many people who were curators and critics and writers and art historians, and then they open up galleries or they have private collections here, and it just has kind of grown out of that. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Well, we appreciate you guys coming.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Hope it was informative.